You're seeing them all around us, maybe. But I'm thankful that you're here. I'm thankful that you're going to bring the message. And most of all, I think I'm thankful that I don't often get to sit with my wife during service. I'm very thankful for that as well. So, John, it's yours.
So if he gives me those glowing remarks right now, we'll see how it is in about 20, 25 minutes. So, when I was asked to bring a message today, this was, I think Perry asked me about 6 weeks ago. So for 5 weeks, I was stressing about it. Not like in a bad way, just like, okay, God, what do you want me to do? What do you want me to say? And I'd be riding on my bike in the morning, or I'd be doing some other things, trying to think, like, what does God really want me to do? And I would write a thought down, this is it, and I'd start writing, and then like a little bit later, I'm like, nope, that's not it. So I ended up with a couple things that I wanted to say, and what I have to say today is we're going to be talking about ourself, not ourselves, but our self, S-E-L-F. And to do that, we when we talk about ourselves, not like our, but when we talk about the self, we can talk about the present self or the past self. And what I brought today was something that I could share with you about myself. This is my high school yearbook from 1985, my senior year. Some of you are going, dang, he's young. And some of you are going, dang, he's old. But I can look through the yearbook and I can talk about my old self. More or less the physical part of me. In fact, as I was flipping through it, and I was going, I don't want to share that, I don't want to share that, there's no way I'm sharing that. Plus, my mom is on Facebook Live right now, and there's no way I want her to know what I did in high school. I did come across a picture that fell out. So, I will let you know now that laughing is permitted, but this is my senior picture.
That's awesome.
I think they need to bring back the fake tuxes. These were fake tuxes in such a way that the back was open, and you just slid your arms in and you held it down, and you took a picture, and you got out, and the next person came in and slid their arms in it. And it was in roundabout way, it's actually gross. But we talk about our old stuff. We look through Facebook, we look through yearbooks, we look through other things to talk about our old self. Like, look what I used to look like. The kids always ask, what did you look like without facial hair? I'm like, well, there you go. Or what did you look like when you were thinner? There you go. What did you look like when you didn't have gray hair? I'm like, well, there you go. But what I don't want to talk about and I don't want to share with you is the old self of the things that I actually did in high school that maybe not were like Christ-like. I mean, there are times that I grew up in church. And my mom tells me I was born in the church. In church on Sunday. I grew up in church and was more or less a good kid, I guess you could say. But there are things that I look back at my old self, especially when I look in this yearbook, and today when I was looking through it this morning, I'm like, oh, the old self wasn't very pleasant. Not so much I was a bad kid, but just who I was, who I wasn't. And so today I want to be talking about what Paul writes in Ephesians chapter 4, verses 17 to 22, referred to. Paul is writing to the church of Ephesus. And so there were some issues at Ephesus during that time. And he writes to the church in such a way that the church readers and us, he poses it in such a way that we look at our old self and we're to look at our new self. And so to start with, in verse 17, Paul writes this, he says, so I tell you this, and insist on it in the Lord, that you must no longer live as the Gentiles do, in the futility of your thinking. They are darkened in their understanding and separated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardening of their hearts. Having lost all sensitivity, they have given themselves over to sensuality, so as to indulge in every kind of impurity, and they are filled with greed. So Paul starts off with this part in the chapter. He's encouraging us. He's encouraging us to live how to live as a Christian. A Christian, someone that professes to follow Christ. When someone says, I'm a Christian, If someone ever introduces me to them from them, if they say, hey, I'm a Christian, I expect to see some Christ-like qualities in them, from their actions, from their speech, and from whatever they're doing. But here, Paul is talking about, he's going to let us know first how not to live a Christian life. Paul is saying, look around you, look at the people that you live with, the Gentiles, so to speak. He says they don't have a sensitivity for the presence of God. That's what he's talking about here. He says these people have lost their sensitivity. Either they haven't heard about God, which then would pivot us to a rabbit hole of saying, how come they haven't heard from God or heard about God if we're living in the same community? Or they turn their back on God, which is another rabbit hole of why did they turn their back on God in the first place. So those are two other sermons that Justin can do later on. But really, what Paul's talking about is they don't notice God at work. So it brings the question to mind, do we actually, as Christians, notice God at work in our lives? Do we see the fingerprints of God in our daily life? Are we really watching and paying attention to that? Are you really watching for God's work in your life, in your daily life? For me, there are times that I do, and there's times that I don't. That is such a political answer. But let me share you what I mean. When I lose that sensitivity, when I lose the ability to see God in my life, then obviously I'm not seeing him and things are going a little haywire at times. I find that actually during the times that I'm losing that sensitivity, it's times when I'm really too busy. I let other things distract me, or I'm harboring unrepentant sin in my life. Those are the times that I start losing my sensitivity to seeing God actively in my life. So that's what Paul is referring to here. He says when we lose that sensitivity, things will go south pretty quickly. And then when they do go south, we wonder why they went south. And Paul's like, just look. Are you watching for God? Are you seeing God's footprints or fingerprints in your life? Are you noticing him on a daily aspect? This is just something that you can start with. If you really want a cool exercise this week, start with get your phone out, have notes up, get a piece of paper. When you see something, that had to be God's mind. That had to be God's mind. This is where I see God working. This is where I see God answering prayer. Start noticing things like that. But when we wonder why, he says that because of losing all that sensitivity, these people have turned themselves over to sensuality. So this is the byproduct of losing that sensitivity, that the Gentiles have given themselves over to sensuality, meaning that they want to feel good. Now, is feeling good a bad thing? Not necessarily. But there are all sorts of ways that we abuse feeling good. And in terms of the specific sins, it can turn into gluttony, it turns into sexual impurity, and so on and so on. And Paul says that they are full of greed. That's what I wanted to center on right now for a second. Greed. When we talk about other people's sins, it's really easy to talk about other people's sin. In fact, it takes the focus off of ourselves and puts it on them, and then we're like, whew, dodge that bullet. But when we talk about people's sins, we tend to forget that when Jesus is talking about sin in the Bible, the sin of greed is one that he talks about quite a bit. In fact, he talks about money, which leads into greed. But he talks about those two things more than anything else. And this is where I think it kind of gets scary. Jesus really doesn't talk about those things that get us all worked up in this current day and age. About politics, about abortion, about gender issues. He doesn't talk about those things in a specific sense. But he does talk about greed in a specific sense. That's why it's so important. When we really look at it, greed stems from what? Self-centeredness. When you yourself are the center of your universe, it produces greed. Anything that is self-centered, that is thinking of ourselves rather than others, which goes against Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 through 4, it's definitionally sin. It's living life around me and what I want rather than what God wants. Greed is basically saying this: what I want is the most important thing, and I can't get enough of it. And when I wrote that out, I'm like, why do I get a picture of a toddler saying that? or of an entitled rich person saying that. This is not a great way to live your life. And pretty much, if you do, you probably won't have a lot of friends or a lot of people wanting to hang out with you. But many of us still do that. So Paul continues, and he says this. He says, here's how your old self was. This is your old self. You lost your sensitivity to God, and you're full of greed, and you're full of sensuality. And Paul said that, however, is not the life you learned when you heard about Christ and were taught in him in accordance with the truth that is in Jesus. You were taught with regard to your former way of life to put off the old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires, to be made new in the attitude of your minds, and to put on the new self created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. Paul states that we are something new. This is the great thing about Christianity, because I can look at this and go, there's a lot of great memories in here, and there's a lot of things that I wish I could forget, but I can't. But I can do this, and I can put it on a shelf, and literally when I took it off the shelf today, it had dust on it. So I can put it on a shelf and never look at it again, and not have to worry about that. I can put off the old self. When we put off the old self, we have chosen to follow Christ. We have accepted his teachings. We accepted the Bible's teaching. And this isn't just a new beliefs layered on old beliefs. Because if you ever have done DIY projects with paint, what happens if you paint over something with paint on it, and then you do it again, and you do it again, and you do it again? You literally have cake, just paint caked all over something, and it doesn't adhere right. So to take a belief system and put it on top of something that you already believe, just like, I'll just add this, and I'll add this, and I'll add this, it gets muddled. When I was in India one time, I was talking to, we were at a Hindu temple, just seeing what was going on, and I asked one of the guys, I said, so how do the Hindus deal with Jesus being the Son of God? And they're like, oh, it's no big deal to them, because they already have 2 million gods, so adding another one to the list is not a big deal. And that's what happens when we layer our beliefs onto something other before getting rid of what we, before we take off that old self. To take off the old self is to put it aside so new self can adhere to it. We have been created again. When this takes place, we set aside that old life, and setting it aside is not to set it aside to retrieve it later on. A lot of people will become a Christian and they're like, but I want to hold on to my old self in certain ways. That's not how it is. Once you put it off, it's gone. That's what it's supposed to be like. But we're messy, and that's not what it's like sometimes. Paul states in Colossians, he states this pretty bluntly. He says that we are to put to death those things that belong to our earthly nature, according to Colossians 3:5. The Greek word for death, necro, literally means the active sense to put to death or to slay, to put an end to the life of something. To put to an end the life of something. That's pretty firm. I think I heard that growing up with my parents when I disobeyed, but that's another story. This isn't a game, though. This is something Christianity is not just something that we add to our life to benefit our lives here on earth. It's a total life change. We are to put to death, to slay, to end the life of that old self. That brings to mind the practice of baptism. When you choose to follow Jesus, you choose to be obedient through the act of baptism. And during this process, it symbolizes your death to the old self, because underwater you can't breathe. So it symbolizes the dying of the old self and raising of the new self. It's symbolic. If you really think about it, that old self continues to pop up even while you're living the new life. It'll try to pop its ugly head and deceive you. The old self is corrupt. It's corrupted by the deceitful desires, Paul states. If you really think about it, a lot of our desires we have are deceitful. If I just get blank, I will be happy. The only thing separating me from happiness is that person, that job, that car. Or for me right now, as I'm looking for a truck, that truck. Whatever it is that we think will bring us happiness, when we get it, right, let's say I buy a truck, makes me happy for a couple weeks, and then the bill comes. that's what happens. We get back to that same thing from our deceitful desires that want us to fill a perceived void in our life. Those desires that keep coming are deceitful, trying to lead us off the path that has been marked out for us. During Thanksgiving and Christmas, it's the perfect time for us to do wonders. To indulge in gluttony. In the name, like, hey, we're just celebrating. And a lot of us have control over it, a lot of us don't. But one thing that we have found in our family is that during those times, all of a sudden the stuff that we haven't been eating, like lots of sugars and cakes and cookies and stuff, all of a sudden bombard us, and now we're eating all those things. So many years ago, Tarn and I had this brilliant idea. A friend of ours told us about this purification diet. And we're like, hey, let's do this right after the new year. So for 21 days, the last 15 years or so, we've been having lots of vegetables, some protein, and some fruit. No pop, no coffee, just water, no sugar, no cookies, no cake, no fun, and so on. So during those 21 days, the first week is torture. It is pure torture. Tarn gets these headaches and it debilitates her. She can't do anything. I get these cravings that are rearing its ugly head saying, I'm letting you know that I'm revolting in your body because you haven't given me sugar. You need to give me sugar or bad things are going to happen. And so then I have to fight with this, not to have sugar, not cupcakes, or the dreaded sourdough bread that I would crave. One year, I craved chimichangas for like 3 or 4 days, and I didn't know why. Why? Why is this? But one year, we decided this year to move it to March because my birthday is in June. And every January for the last 15 years, you would have to forego a birthday cake, which isn't fun. Though one year, this is funny, carrot cake is my favorite cake, and the girls made me a carrot cake. And so they had said, hey, we made you a carrot cake. And I'm like, okay, yeah, I'm going to cheat on this. I don't care. They brought out a carrot cake and a pie plan that was literally 1-inch slices of carrot, raw carrot, and just right, and put candles all over it and said, happy birthday. I'm like, this is cruel. This is really cruel. But it's those deceitful desires. Those desires that are telling my body, you're craving sugar. If you just had this cookie, especially when I worked at a church, they'd have cookie tables out, and the deceitful desire, and it sounds silly, but the deceitful desire would say, if you just eat that cookie, no one will know. You can tell Tarn, she's probably going to say whatever. But if you eat it, you'll feel better. And I'm like, yes, I will. For about 25 minutes. And then all of a sudden, because my body's been detoxed from carbs and sugar, I will feel horrible. And then I'm right back to where I was. That desire is deceitful for me. Same desires that pop up in our life. It's a deceitful desire that says you will be happy, you will be fulfilled, you will be satisfied if you have blank or if you blank. It's not that way. Paul continues, he says, therefore, each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to your neighbor, for we are all members of one body. And you're saying, anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you're still angry. And do not give the devil a foothold. If anyone who has been stealing must steal no longer, but must work doing something useful with their own hands, that he may have something to share with those in need. The Bible speaks a lot about truthfulness. Jesus, Paul, and the other writers would not be big fans of alternative facts. There are those times that we are going to disagree as Christians. And it's okay. If it's not a salvation issue, it's okay to disagree. Right now, I'm taking a class online, and we're taking it's biology, and we're talking about evolution. And it's from a Christian college, so the professor in the video says, I'm a Christian, this is what I believe from the Bible. But as a scientist, I'm going to share what evolution says. So they're not saying you have to agree with any of it, but they're presenting both sides. And in the class, there are some people that aren't Christians and some people that are Christians, so the debate in the discussion boards are interesting. But they're not hurtful or angry. That's a big difference that I see at this place that I'm going to. But he says, disagree. We're going to disagree as Christians, but let's at least continue to think about truth. Let's search for and honor truth and truthfulness, and especially in our individual dealings with one another. He says, don't sin. You're going to get angry. Don't sin. It's not anger that is the sin. Things can make us get angry. Injustice gets us angry. The trafficking realm, human trafficking, makes us angry. Certain sins make us angry. Abortion, whatever it is, we get angry because of our righteousness. But in that anger is not a sin. It's what we do with that anger that can be the sin. So he says, during those times that we may be angry, we're not allowed to let the sun go down, meaning don't let those things build up. When you're angry, don't let them build up. Don't let them fester, because they're not going to get better. They're going to get bitter. I ran across a quote from this missionary, E. Stanley Jones. And actually, after I read it, I researched it because I'm like, is this really true? And it is true. So I'm going to read what he said. He said, a rattlesnake, if cornered, will become so angry, it will bite itself. That's exactly what harboring of hate and resentment against others is, a biting of oneself. We think we are harming others and holding these fights and hates, but the deeper harm is to ourselves. That kind of encapsulated what I was thinking about, what I saw Paul talking about. And it's actually kind of scary that in our anger, we're actually doing more harm to ourselves if we allow it to continue to harbor. When we forget how to talk through our anger with the person that we're angry with, when we forget how to converse with that person, we will continue to be angry, and we're going to spew out anger towards one another. I was thinking of an illustration to illustrate this fact. Sadly, the thing that came to mind was the political arena. Both sides have ceased to really talk and converse with each other. And what's now, what you see across the globe, is anger being vomited all over the place. And it's so much so that it makes most of us sick when we see it. Paul mentions stealing. Change gears. Now remember, he's writing this letter to the church of Ephesus, not to the general population of the city of Ephesus. So if he's writing about stealing, then there's an issue within that body of believers. If you want evidence that Christians are not perfect, here it is. We are a messy group of people that are constantly struggling to do the right things and to follow Jesus with all that we have. Paul is having to tell his readers that are currently within the church, you need to stop stealing. It's kind of like at work. When there's no policies, people kind of tend to abuse things, and when a policy is made, it's because someone did something dumb, and now they have to make a policy for it. So here, Paul hears about people stealing, so he has to tell the church, stop stealing. Stop stealing and start doing something good. Now, stealing could be as little as shoplifting from Dollar General, cheating on your taxes, stealing office supplies from work, but he's saying you have to stop that and start doing something useful. Stop stealing, start sharing with one another. And continuing on, he says, do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Get rid of all bitterness, rage, anger, brawling, slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. This section of it, I sat on for a number of days, and when I was riding my bike, I would listen to myself talking to God. If you see me riding my bike in the morning and my lips are moving, that probably means I'm talking to God. So don't think that someone has lost it while they're riding their bike. But what was hitting me was get rid of all bitterness, rage, anger, brawling, slander, along with every form of malice. I'm like, where is that in my life, God? And I was asking God for specifics. Show me where that is in my life so I can replace it with kind and compassion, forgiveness. So, but when I started thinking about it, I was like, I went up to the first part of it. It says, don't let any unwholesome talk. The guy in here probably didn't have a lot of wholesome talk coming out. I did when I was at home, but probably not at school. Probably probably not out of wilderness. But now I've done a pretty good job of trying to keep my words in check. I have spent a long time, a lot of my life, I'm trying to control what comes out of my mouth. In fact, one time when I was working downtown Chicago before we moved out here, I was working at an online brokerage firm doing tech support for their software. And I'd have to talk to clients about certain software and issues that they're having. And one time one of my coworkers came up and says, "You know what, you're kind of weird." And I said, "What do you mean?" He goes, "I never hear you get angry with the clients." I'm like, "Okay." I'm like, "Is that a bad thing?" He's like, "No, it's just odd." And so I thought it was funny, but I thought it was affirming too. Because I also listened to some of my coworkers who literally put their phone on mute and swear at the client. I mean, just like screaming at the phone. And they were, one guy, we called him Angry Mike, and he would like bang on his desk, and he would belittle people. And I'm like, how are you not fired yet? But we have to keep in check what we're doing. There are many of us who are really good about keeping our tongue in check. In fact, James chapter 3 devotes this whole chapter going through the dangers of not keeping our tongue in check. What we say has power, the power to uplift, the power to encourage, to comfort, and convey compassion. But on the other side of that, the tongue has the power to destroy and hurt. It can demean and belittle another person. It can spread lies, gossip, and pain. Now, many of us here probably have a good source of don't let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouth. Okay, I think we're doing okay. But I was thinking of this. If Paul was to write that in the context of our culture now, he might say this. When posting online, don't do anything to encourage anger. Don't promote trash talk. Don't be mean and bully people with your posts or comments. Stop complaining. Stop using Twitter, Facebook, TikTok, Snapchat to gossip. Stop airing out your grievances with each other in the public setting. Stop using social media platforms as a way to not be Christ-like and vent things that are not productive to the body of Christ, but rather use your online presence to spread love, share the gospel, and draw people to Christ. Use your online presence to allow the new self to be in control. And when I wrote that, I was like, ouch, because now it relates to us a lot differently, because I might not say it from here in the pulpit or outside, but I might jump on Twitter and say something derogatory or something I just saw. And when other people say that, like, "I thought you were a Christian." I am. I'm just venting. Paul's saying, no, stop. When we allow the negative characteristics that Paul shares in this passage to continue to be exhibited in our lives, it grieves the Holy Spirit. And people have asked me, and I'm sure they've asked Justin as well, what specifically grieves the Holy Spirit? Because I don't want to do that. Well, the short answer is this. The Holy Spirit is grieved by unholiness. And since he is the one Spirit, disunity will cause him grief. In fact, anything incompatible with the purity or unity of the church, and that's the people, not the building, if it's incompatible with his own nature, it hurts him. For the Holy Spirit is a sensitive spirit. He hates sin, he hates discord, falsehood, and shrinks away from it. Therefore, if we wish to avoid hurting them, we will shrink away from those issues too. Every spirit-filled believer should have the desire to bring pleasure to the Holy Spirit, not pain. And I want to stress here that the passage in Ephesians, Paul is addressing the local community of believers. He's writing to the church because he cares about them and loves them. He's writing in such a way that says, this is how you were, but you were taught differently, so now be like this. So that old self that you were is put off. You follow Jesus, you follow the teachings of Jesus, you listen to Scripture, you adhere to Scripture, you start practicing what you learn, and you become more like Christ, and the new self starts to shine. As believers in Christ, we follow the teachings found within Scripture, not out of obligation, but out of the freedom that Jesus gives us. Jesus gives us the ability to say, yeah, I read Ephesians. I don't want to. as we continue to navigate this journey on a daily basis, let's take the word from Paul in this passage and strive to allow the guidance to take root in such a way that we can continue to create unity in this local body here. Then, in that unity in the local body here, you take it to the community of New and the outline communities, and you start making a difference there. The reason that you do this is that other people will start seeing that. Other people will start noticing the change. Other people will start commenting on what's different. And they'll probably want something of that nature, because the void that you have filled is not with a deceitful desire, but it's rather with the Spirit of the Holy Spirit. It's the Spirit of God that lives in us. And when we do that, we will have a new self that is being continually developed through the Holy Spirit. Heavenly Father, thank you for the book of Ephesians and for the bluntness of Paul and just calling things out as he sees them and doing it in such a way that he contrasts the old self with the new self and encourages us how to live that way. Father, as we continue to live that way, just as we're messy and we feel at times, I just pray that you will continue to allow your forgiveness to wash over us, give us that sense of peace, and to continue to strengthen and encourage us to continue with our journey.